Listening test. You will hear a number of different recordings, and you will have to answer questions on what you hear. There will be time for you to read the instructions and questions, and you'll have time to check your work. At the start of each recording, you'll hear this sound. You will hear each recording twice. The test is in four parts. At the end of the test, you'll be given 2 minutes to check your answers.
In the age of food delivery apps like Uber Eats, Skip the Dishes, and DoorDash, it's hard to imagine this type of convenience without the technology. But there is one food delivery service which sends out more than 200,000 meals a day and has been doing so for the past 130 years. They are the Mumbai Dabbawalas, also known as Dabbawalas. In about 4 hours, they deliver home-cooked meals to people at work every day. And all without using modern technology. Mumbai Dabbawalas employs about 5,000 people. Many of them have had little to no education and have never learned to read. So how do they keep these orders in order? The Dabbawalas get on their bicycles around 9 a.m. and pick up homemade lunches from their assigned neighborhoods, which are generally the same every day, using what's called dabbas, or Indian lunchboxes. After picking up the lunchboxes, usually made by the partners, parents, or house staff of the intended recipient, they have until 10:30 a.m. to bike to the nearest train station. Over the next hour, they load all of the lunchboxes on the train. This is where keeping track of everything gets really tough, but they use a pretty basic trick.
A vital part of their delivery service is a coding system, so the lids are labeled with letters, numbers, and symbols indicating where these lunchboxes have to be delivered to, who's delivering them, and the homes where they came from.
Between 11:30 and 12, the Dabbawalas offload from the train and continue sorting. Between noon and 1, they deliver lunches to their clients. During this hour, over 200,000 deliveries are made across Mumbai.
They all kind of have to work together in harmony in order to allow sort of the Dabbawalas to perform sort of at the level of performance.
The Mumbai Dabbawalas are known for being punctual with their deliveries. Their mission statement since they first started running in 1890 has been to always deliver on time.
They believe that delivering lunch is like delivering medicine. And so now as a mission statement, right, when you sort of think about that, you're not just delivering lunches to people, you're saving people's lives.
The Dabbawalas don't just deliver lunches to people at work. They also pick up lunchboxes from the individuals after they're done and deliver them back to their homes the same day. All this efficiency has the business community intrigued, including Harvard Business School, which has done a case study.
The simplicity of sort of how they do things actually help them, so they don't have to deal with sort of a lot of complexity that we're sort of typically find. So sometimes, you know, keeping things quite simple and be laser focused on what it is that you're trying to achieve is really important.
Tom Kay spent a day with the Dabbawalas in Mumbai for his research and thinks companies around the world can learn from the Mumbai Dabbawalas. In an age where we are so focused on modern technology, sometimes the best plan is the simplest.
Now listen again.
In the age of food delivery apps like Uber Eats, Skip the Dishes, and DoorDash, it's hard to imagine this type of convenience without the technology. But there is one food delivery service which sends out more than 200,000 meals a day and has been doing so for the past 130 years. They are the Mumbai Dabbawalas, also known as Dabbawalas. In about 4 hours, they deliver home-cooked meals to people at work every day. And all without using modern technology.
Mumbai Dabbawalas employs about 5,000 people. Many of them have had little to no education and have never learned to read. So how do they keep these orders in order?
The Dabbawalas get on their bicycles around 9 a.m. and pick up homemade lunches from their assigned neighborhoods, which are generally the same every day, using what's called dabbas, or Indian lunchboxes. After picking up the lunchboxes, usually made by the partners, parents, or house staff of the intended recipient, they have until 10:30 a.m. to bike to the nearest train station. Over the next hour, they load all of the lunchboxes on the train. This is where keeping track of everything gets really tough, but they use a pretty basic trick.
A vital part of their delivery service is a coding system, so the lids are labeled with letters, numbers, and symbols indicating where these lunchboxes have to be delivered to, who's delivering them, and the homes where they came from.
Between 11:30 and 12, the Dabbawalas offload from the train and continue sorting. Between noon and 1, they deliver lunches to their clients. During this hour, over 200,000 deliveries are made across Mumbai.
They all kind of have to work together in harmony in order to allow sort of the Dabbawalas to perform sort of at the level of performance.
The Mumbai Dabbawalas are known for being punctual with their deliveries. Their mission statement since they first started running in 1890 has been to always deliver on time.
They believe that delivering lunch is like delivering medicine. And so now as a mission statement, right, when you sort of think about that, you're not just delivering lunches to people, you're saving people's lives.
The Dabbawalas don't just deliver lunches to people at work. They also pick up lunchboxes from the individuals after they're done and deliver them back to their homes the same day. All this efficiency has the business community intrigued, including Harvard Business School, which has done a case study.
The simplicity of sort of how they do things actually help them, so they don't have to deal with sort of a lot of complexity that we're sort of typically find. So sometimes, you know, keeping things quite simple and be laser focused on what it is that you're trying to achieve is really important.
Tom Kay spent a day with the Dabbawalas in Mumbai for his research and thinks companies around the world can learn from the Mumbai Dabbawalas. In an age where we are so focused on modern technology, sometimes the best plan is the simplest.
To the Chinese, he was the barbarian scourge born from the wastes. To the Europeans, he was a demonic servant, leading a detestable nation of Satan that poured like devils from Tartarus. To human history, though, he was one of the greatest warlords in history. We're talking, of course, about Genghis Khan. Genghis Khan was born sometime around 1162 AD, and originally named Temujin after a Tartar chief that his father had captured. Greatness marked Genghis from birth, not just in the heritage of his mighty bloodline, but physically, with a literal mark caused by a blood clot in his head. To the superstitious Mongols, this meant that Genghis was destined to become a great leader. Young Genghis, though, would have a hard education and survival ahead of him, amidst the various clans that made up the Mongol lands. When he was just 9 years old, his father took him to live with the family of his future bride. And on the return trip, his father encountered members of a rival tribe, who invited him home with them to share in a conciliatory meal. Believing that the rival tribe members meant to bury the hatchet over past transgressions, Genghis' father agreed and dined with them, only to be poisoned. When Genghis learned of his father's death, he immediately returned home to claim his position as clan chief. However, the rest of the clan refused to acknowledge the leadership of a 9-year-old boy, and his family was ostracized, becoming near refugees in their own tribe. Genghis vowed revenge and to never be laughed at again. So when during a dispute over the spoils of a hunting expedition he quarreled with his half-brother, Genghis killed him and confirmed his position as the head of his family. The young chieftain was yet a child and had already learned the harsh truths of Mongol life. Power is won by blood spilled, and very often held the same way. At 16 years old, Genghis married the woman he had long ago been promised to, a young girl by the name of Borte. This marriage cemented the alliance between her tribe and his, but soon after the wedding, Genghis's wife was kidnapped by a rival tribe and given to their chieftain as a wife. Genghis, along with his close friend Jamukha and his older protector Toghrul, raided the rival tribe's camp and rescued his bride. Eventually, Genghis would have 4 sons with Borte, and though during the course of his rule would take many other wives and have many other children, Borte alone would remain his lifelong companion, and only his male children with her would qualify for succession in the family. His daring escape from captivity fueled Genghis's reputation, and he formed a fighting unit out of his brothers and some of his most trusted clansmen, believing that his people would never truly become great until they ceased the petty infighting and rivalries between the various clans. Genghis took his small force out into the steppes and began to unite the clans together one by one. His goal was simple. He would destroy all the divisions between his people, through slaughter if he had to, and the Mongols would at last become one people, a mighty nation to rival the powers of China. Young Genghis's small force would swell to an elite fighting force of 20,000 battle-hardened warriors. A brilliant tactical mind combined with savage brutality, Genghis proved an exceptional battlefield commander, and his fighting force met its first true challenge when Genghis turned his army on the Tartars, who had murdered his father so long ago.
Now listen again.
To the Chinese, he was the barbarian scourge born from the wastes. To the Europeans, he was a demonic servant, leading a detestable nation of Satan that poured like devils from Tartarus. To human history, though, he was one of the greatest warlords in history. We're talking, of course, about Genghis Khan. Genghis Khan was born sometime around 1162 AD, and originally named Temujin after a Tartar chief that his father had captured. Greatness marked Genghis from birth, not just in the heritage of his mighty bloodline, but physically, with a literal mark caused by a blood clot in his head. To the superstitious Mongols, this meant that Genghis was destined to become a great leader. Young Genghis, though, would have a hard education and survival ahead of him, amidst the various clans that made up the Mongol lands. When he was just 9 years old, his father took him to live with the family of his future bride. And on the return trip, his father encountered members of a rival tribe, who invited him home with them to share in a conciliatory meal. Believing that the rival tribe members meant to bury the hatchet over past transgressions, Genghis's father agreed and dined with them, only to be poisoned. When Genghis learned of his father's death, he immediately returned home to claim his position as clan chief. However, the rest of the clan refused to acknowledge the leadership of a 9-year-old boy, and his family was ostracized, becoming near refugees in their own tribe. Genghis vowed revenge and to never be laughed at again. So when, during a dispute over the spoils of a hunting expedition, he quarreled with his half-brother, Genghis killed him and confirmed his position as the head of his family. The young chieftain was yet a child and had already learned the harsh truths of Mongol life. Power is won by blood spilled, and very often held the same way. At 16 years old, Genghis married the woman he had long ago been promised to, a young girl by the name of Borte. This marriage cemented the alliance between her tribe and his, but soon after the wedding, Genghis's wife was kidnapped by a rival tribe and given to their chieftain as a wife. Genghis, along with his close friend Jamukha and his older protector Toghrul, raided the rival tribe's camp and rescued his bride. Eventually, Genghis would have 4 sons with Borte, and though during the course of his rule would take many other wives and have many other children, Borte alone would remain his lifelong companion, and only his male children with her would qualify for succession in the family. His daring escape from captivity fueled Genghis's reputation, and he formed a fighting unit out of his brothers and some of his most trusted clansmen, believing that his people would never truly become great until they ceased the petty infighting and rivalries between the various clans. Genghis took his small force out into the steppes and began to unite the clans together one by one. His goal was simple. He would destroy all the divisions between his people, through slaughter if he had to, and the Mongols would at last become one people, a mighty nation to rival the powers of China. Young Genghis's small force would swell to an elite fighting force of 20,000 battle-hardened warriors. A brilliant tactical mind combined with savage brutality, Genghis proved an exceptional battlefield commander, and his fighting force met its first true challenge when Genghis turned his army on the Tartars, who had murdered his father so long ago.
Now turn to part 3. You will hear a radio program in which two people, Max Verstapp and Cara O'Dell, are discussing amateur photography. For questions 16 to 20, choose the answer A, B, C, or D, which fits best according to what you hear. You now have 1 minute in which to look at part 3.
A warm welcome to Max Verstapp and Cara Odell, who join me on today's episode of Camera in Focus to offer their insights and advice for would-be photographers out there. Cara, as a professional photographer, I'd like to turn to you first. What advice do you have for amateurs just starting out? Photography, after all, can be a very expensive game.
There is no disputing that, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. There are, for example, some wonderful second-hand options on the market, and it is possible to get your mitts on some really good equipment at an excellent price.
I think that's sage advice from Cara, actually. This must sound strange coming from the owner of a camera shop, but I would advise against amateurs spending big money on equipment until they get a feel for what they really want to get out of their photography. Second-hand is definitely one excellent route down which to go. However, bear in mind that advances in technology have made the impossible possible, so to speak, in the field of photography today, and even cheaper new camera units can produce some quite impressive results. I'd lean towards recommending this latter option.
Indeed, Max has a point. Even the mobile phone cannot be totally dismissed anymore. Some of the latest models can rival even expensive purpose-built cameras for everyday purposes. However, they have their limitations, and there remains no substitute for specialist equipment if you desire the best results.
Absolutely, Cara. My point is, find your feet and find the area that appeals to you before spending on the relevant equipment. Experiment first. Find your niche.
Okay, so, mobile phones aside, what kind of camera would you recommend for a novice photographer?
Well, ideally, a cheap DSLR. That's a camera that lets you change the lens for different purposes. There are some excellent value ones on the market now, especially second-hand.
I would be hesitant about recommending the DSLR, actually. Notwithstanding the high-quality images even cheaper models can produce, I think new photographers can be somewhat put off by their seeming complexity, and also, more crucially, by having to carry a lot of kit, for example, numerous different lenses.
I'm glad Max used the word seeming, because the level of effort it takes to familiarise yourself with the workings of a DSLR is not gargantuan by any means.
No, that's true, Cara, but personally I would favour a single-lens camera, something a bit more versatile and portable. For example, a bridge camera. These tend to be slightly more affordable than DSLRs, yet they have most of the same functionality, allowing users to experiment and become familiar with different camera settings without being overawed.
What about compact system cameras? Are these any good?
Oh, without question. Indeed, the higher-end ones are replacing the DSLRs in the kit of many a professional photographer today. However, they tend to be out of most people's price range. A mid-range compact camera, however, is comparatively expensive when compared to a second-hand DSLR or new bridge camera. Therefore, I would personally go with one of these instead.
Yes, Cara. Again, I think the trick is not to invest heavily until you understand what you want to get out of photography. I would caution against the low-end compact system cameras. The build and image quality are dubious, but it's true that mid-range and upwards, the quality is unquestioned. However, why fork out on one of them when there are inexpensive alternatives that yield similar results, such as the two options we have mentioned already?
Is there anything to be said for your average point-and-shoot camera these days, Max?
Well, from the point of view that anything that gets people out and about taking shots and experimenting is a good thing, they have their merits. I would say on a par with a mobile phone camera, for example, which, incidentally, begs the question, why buy something that you already have? However, I think realistically for those wanting to advance their skills, there are better avenues into photography that are just as affordable.
I would echo Max's sentiments there, really, and add that the best way to go...
Now you will hear part three again.
A warm welcome to Max Verstapp and Cara Odell, who join me on today's episode of Camera in Focus to offer their insights and advice for would-be photographers out there. Cara, as a professional photographer, I'd like to turn to you first. What advice do you have for amateurs just starting out? Photography, after all, can be a very expensive game.
There is no disputing that, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. There are, for example, some wonderful second-hand options on the market, and it is possible to get your mitts on some really good equipment at an excellent price.
I think that's sage advice from Cara, actually. This must sound strange coming from the owner of a camera shop, but I would advise against amateurs spending big money on equipment until they get a feel for what they really want to get out of their photography. Second-hand is definitely one excellent route down which to go. However, bear in mind that advances in technology have made the impossible possible, so to speak, in the field of photography today, and even cheaper new camera units can produce some quite impressive results. I'd lean towards recommending this latter option.
Indeed, Max has a point. Even the mobile phone cannot be totally dismissed anymore. Some of the latest models can rival even expensive purpose-built cameras for everyday purposes. However, they have their limitations, and there remains no substitute for specialist equipment if you desire the best results.
Absolutely, Cara. My point is, find your feet and find the area that appeals to you before spending on the relevant equipment. Experiment first. Find your niche.
Okay, so, mobile phones aside, what kind of camera would you recommend for a novice photographer?
Well, ideally, a cheap DSLR. That's a camera that lets you change the lens for different purposes. There are some excellent value ones on the market now, especially second-hand.
I would be hesitant about recommending the DSLR, actually. Notwithstanding the high-quality images even cheaper models can produce, I think new photographers can be somewhat put off by their seeming complexity, and also, more crucially, by having to carry a lot of kit, for example, numerous different lenses.
I'm glad Max used the word seeming, because the level of effort it takes to familiarise yourself with the workings of a DSLR is not gargantuan by any means.
No, that's true, Cara, but personally I would favour a single-lens camera, something a bit more versatile and portable. For example, a bridge camera. These tend to be slightly more affordable than DSLRs, yet they have most of the same functionality, allowing users to experiment and become familiar with different camera settings without being overawed.
What about compact system cameras? Are these any good?
Oh, without question. Indeed, the higher-end ones are replacing the DSLRs in the kit of many a professional photographer today. However, they tend to be out of most people's price range. A mid-range compact camera, however, is comparatively expensive when compared to a second-hand DSLR or new bridge camera. Therefore, I would personally go with one of these instead.
Yes, Cara. Again, I think the trick is not to invest heavily until you understand what you want to get out of photography. I would caution against the low-end compact system cameras. The build and image quality are dubious, but it's true that mid-range and upwards, the quality is unquestioned. However, why fork out on one of them when there are inexpensive alternatives that yield similar results, such as the two options we have mentioned already?
Is there anything to be said for your average point-and-shoot camera these days, Max?
Well, from the point of view that anything that gets people out and about taking shots and experimenting is a good thing, they have their merits. I would say on a par with a mobile phone camera, for example, which, incidentally, begs the question, why buy something that you already have? However, I think realistically for those wanting to advance their skills, there are better avenues into photography that are just as affordable.
I would echo Max's sentiments there, really, and add that the best way to go...
That is the end of part three.
Now listen again.
Now turn to part three. You will hear a radio program in which two people, Max Verstappen and Cara O'Dell, are discussing amateur photography. For questions 16 to 20, choose the answer A, B, C or D, which fits best according to what you hear. You now have 1 minute in which to look at part three.
A warm welcome to Max Verstapp and Cara Odell, who join me on today's episode of Camera in Focus to offer their insights and advice for would-be photographers out there. Cara, as a professional photographer, I'd like to turn to you first. What advice do you have for amateurs just starting out? Photography, after all, can be a very expensive game.
There is no disputing that, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. There are, for example, some wonderful second-hand options on the market, and it is possible to get your mitts on some really good equipment at an excellent price.
I think that's sage advice from Cara, actually. This must sound strange coming from the owner of a camera shop, but I would advise against amateurs spending big money on equipment until they get a feel for what they really want to get out of their photography. Second-hand is definitely one excellent route down which to go. However, bear in mind that advances in technology have made the impossible possible, so to speak, in the field of photography today, and even cheaper new camera units can produce some quite impressive results. I'd lean towards recommending this latter option.
Indeed, Max has a point. Even the mobile phone cannot be totally dismissed anymore. Some of the latest models can rival even expensive purpose-built cameras for everyday purposes. However, they have their limitations, and there remains no substitute for specialist equipment if you desire the best results.
Absolutely, Cara. My point is, find your feet and find the area that appeals to you before spending on the relevant equipment. Experiment first. Find your niche.
Okay, so, mobile phones aside, what kind of camera would you recommend for a novice photographer?
Well, ideally, a cheap DSLR. That's a camera that lets you change the lens for different purposes. There are some excellent value ones on the market now, especially second-hand.
I would be hesitant about recommending the DSLR, actually. Notwithstanding the high-quality images even cheaper models can produce, I think new photographers can be somewhat put off by their seeming complexity, and also, more crucially, by having to carry a lot of kit, for example, numerous different lenses.
I'm glad Max used the word seeming, because the level of effort it takes to familiarise yourself with the workings of a DSLR is not gargantuan by any means.
No, that's true, Cara, but personally I would favour a single-lens camera, something a bit more versatile and portable. For example, a bridge camera. These tend to be slightly more affordable than DSLRs, yet they have most of the same functionality, allowing users to experiment and become familiar with different camera settings without being overawed.
What about compact system cameras? Are these any good?
Oh, without question. Indeed, the higher-end ones are replacing the DSLRs in the kit of many a professional photographer today. However, they tend to be out of most people's price range. A mid-range compact camera, however, is comparatively expensive when compared to a second-hand DSLR or new bridge camera. Therefore, I would personally go with one of these instead.
Yes, Cara. Again, I think the trick is not to invest heavily until you understand what you want to get out of photography. I would caution against the low-end compact system cameras. The build and image quality are dubious, but it's true that mid-range and upwards, the quality is unquestioned. However, why fork out on one of them when there are inexpensive alternatives that yield similar results, such as the two options we have mentioned already?
Is there anything to be said for your average point-and-shoot camera these days, Max?
Well, from the point of view that anything that gets people out and about taking shots and experimenting is a good thing, they have their merits. I would say on a par with a mobile phone camera, for example, which, incidentally, begs the question, why buy something that you already have? However, I think realistically for those wanting to advance their skills, there are better avenues into photography that are just as affordable.
I would echo Max's sentiments there, really, and add that the best way to go about
Now you will hear part three again.
A warm welcome to Max Verstappen and Cara Odell, who join me on today's episode of Camera in Focus to offer their insights and advice for would-be photographers out there. Cara, as a professional photographer, I'd like to turn to you first. What advice do you have for amateurs just starting out? Photography, after all, can be a very expensive game.
There is no disputing that, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. There are, for example, some wonderful second-hand options on the market, and it is possible to get your mitts on some really good equipment at an excellent price.
I think that's sage advice from Cara, actually. This must sound strange coming from the owner of a camera shop, but I would advise against amateurs spending big money on equipment until they get a feel for what they really want to get out of their photography. Second-hand is definitely one excellent route down which to go. However, bear in mind that advances in technology have made the impossible possible, so to speak, in the field of photography today, and even cheaper new camera units can produce some quite impressive results. I'd lean towards recommending this latter option.
Indeed, Max has a point. Even the mobile phone cannot be totally dismissed anymore. Some of the latest models can rival even expensive purpose-built cameras for everyday purposes. However, they have their limitations, and there remains no substitute for specialist equipment if you desire the best results.
Absolutely, Cara. My point is, find your feet and find the area that appeals to you before spending on the relevant equipment. Experiment first. Find your niche.
Okay, so, mobile phones aside, what kind of camera would you recommend for a novice photographer?
Well, ideally, a cheap DSLR. That's a camera that lets you change the lens for different purposes. There are some excellent value ones on the market now, especially second-hand.
I would be hesitant about recommending the DSLR, actually. Notwithstanding the high-quality images even cheaper models can produce, I think new photographers can be somewhat put off by their seeming complexity, and also, more crucially, by having to carry a lot of kit, for example, numerous different lenses.
I'm glad Max used the word seeming, because the level of effort it takes to familiarise yourself with the workings of a DSLR is not gargantuan by any means.
No, that's true, Cara, but personally I would favour a single-lens camera, something a bit more versatile and portable. For example, a bridge camera. These tend to be slightly more affordable than DSLRs, yet they have most of the same functionality, allowing users to experiment and become familiar with different camera settings without being overawed.
What about compact system cameras? Are these any good?
Oh, without question. Indeed, the higher-end ones are replacing the DSLRs in the kit of many a professional photographer today. However, they tend to be out of most people's price range. A mid-range compact camera, however, is comparatively expensive when compared to a second-hand DSLR or new bridge camera. Therefore, I would personally go with one of these instead.
Yes, Cara. Again, I think the trick is not to invest heavily until you understand what you want to get out of photography. I would caution against the low-end compact system cameras. The build and image quality are dubious, but it's true that mid-range and upwards, the quality is unquestioned. However, why fork out on one of them when there are inexpensive alternatives that yield similar results, such as the two options we have mentioned already?
Is there anything to be said for your average point-and-shoot camera these days, Max?
Well, from the point of view that anything that gets people out and about taking shots and experimenting is a good thing, they have their merits. I would say on a par with a mobile phone camera, for example, which, incidentally, begs the question, why buy something that you already have? However, I think realistically for those wanting to advance their skills, there are better avenues into photography that are just as affordable.
I would echo Max's sentiments there, really, and add that the best way to go about
that is the end of part three.
The stone city of Machu Picchu is one of the most fascinating archaeological sites on the planet. Located northwest of Cusco, Peru, Machu Picchu is a testament to the power and ingenuity of the Inca people. During its prime, the Inca civilization stretched about 2,500 miles along South America's Pacific coastline from modern-day Ecuador down into Chile. This distance is nearly the horizontal width of the continental United States. Machu Picchu located at the center of this once expansive empire, is one of the few well-preserved remnants of the Inca civilization. Built around the mid-15th century, Machu Picchu is a stunning example of the Inca's engineering feats. The Inca constructed Machu Picchu's palaces, temples, terraces, and infrastructure using stone, and without the help of wheels or tools made of steel or iron. One particularly notable aspect of their construction is foregoing the use of mortar, a material often used to bind stones together. Nonetheless, the stones of Machu Picchu were cut so precisely that they snugly fit together. Located on two fault lines, Machu Picchu often experiences earthquakes, but because of the stone's exceptional cut and fit, they bounce during tremors and then are able to easily fall back into position. These engineering marvels have preserved Machu Picchu's remarkable condition for over 500 years. Machu Picchu's purpose is still a mystery to many archaeologists. Some theorize that it may have served as a ceremonial site, a military stronghold, or a retreat for nobility. The site's geographic layout may be significant in another way. Many of both the man-made and natural structures appear to align with astronomical events. But in the early 16th century, only about 100 years after it was built, Machu Picchu was abandoned. And since the Inca had no written language, no records exist to explain the exact purpose of the site. Although local communities knew about Machu Picchu, the site remained largely unknown to the outside world for hundreds of years. Spanish conquistadors, who invaded the Inca civilization in the 16th century, never came across the site. It wasn't until the early 20th century when Melchor Arteaga, a local farmer, debuted Machu Picchu to outsiders when he led Yale University professor Hiram Bingham to the site. Bingham and successive explorers devoted much of their academic careers to studying the archaeological wonder. Despite its enigmatic nature, Machu Picchu still stands as one of the world's most important archaeological sites. It is a testament to the power and ingenuity of one of the largest empires in the Americas. In 1983, UNESCO designated Machu Picchu as a World Heritage Site, and today, visitors from around the world come to pay homage to this piece of history.
Now listen again.
The stone city of Machu Picchu is one of the most fascinating archaeological sites on the planet. Located northwest of Cusco, Peru, Machu Picchu is a testament to the power and ingenuity of the Inca people. During its prime, the Inca civilization stretched about 2,500 miles along South America's Pacific coastline from modern-day Ecuador down into Chile. This distance is nearly the horizontal width of the continental United States. Machu Picchu, located at the center of this once expansive empire, is one of the few well-preserved remnants of the Inca civilization. Built around the mid-15th century, Machu Picchu is a stunning example of the Inca's engineering feats. The Inca constructed Machu Picchu's palaces, temples, terraces, and infrastructure using stone, and without the help of wheels or tools made of steel or iron. One particularly notable aspect of their construction is foregoing the use of mortar, a material often used to bind stones together. Nonetheless, the stones of Machu Picchu were cut so precisely that they snugly fit together. Located on two fault lines, Machu Picchu often experiences earthquakes, but because of the stone's exceptional cut and fit, they bounce during tremors and then are able to easily fall back into position. These engineering marvels have preserved Machu Picchu's remarkable condition for over 500 years. Machu Picchu's purpose is still a mystery to many archaeologists. Some theorize that it may have served as a ceremonial site, a military stronghold, or a retreat for nobility. The site's geographic layout may be significant in another way. Many of both the man-made and natural structures appear to align with astronomical events. But in the early 16th century, only about 100 years after it was built, Machu Picchu was abandoned. and since the Inca had no written language, no records exist to explain the exact purpose of the site. Although local communities knew about Machu Picchu, the site remained largely unknown to the outside world for hundreds of years. Spanish conquistadors, who invaded the Inca civilization in the 16th century, never came across the site. It wasn't until the early 20th century when Melchor Arteaga, a local farmer, debuted Machu Picchu to outsiders when he led Yale University professor Hiram Bingham to the site. Bingham and successive explorers devoted much of their academic careers to studying the archaeological wonder. Despite its enigmatic nature, Machu Picchu still stands as one of the world's most important archaeological sites. It is a testament to the power and ingenuity of one of the largest empires in the Americas. In 1983, UNESCO designated Machu Picchu as a World Heritage Site, and today, visitors from around the world come to pay homage to this piece of history.